Thank you, everyone. So on behalf of the panel, and I thank you all for coming, and I hope we can teach you all something, or at least show you some things about security metrics today. And I'm looking forward to a lively discussion at the end with questions and give and take with our panel members. My name is Alan Shimel. I'm the managing partner of the CISO Group and also CEO of a soon-to-be-launched site next week, devops.com. And if anyone's interested in that, I could talk to you later. Let me quickly introduce our panelists. I'm going to start over here. It's Andrew McCullough, to my immediate right. Andrew is an ESS expert at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise Security Services. Next to Andrew's right is Mr. Jody Brazil. Jody is the president and CTO of FireMon. And then if you haven't guessed, Ivana Cojbasic. And Ivana is the VP of Security at FIS, which formerly known as Fidelity Information Services. I think we have a great panel to discuss security metrics, and let's jump into it. So I've been in security myself for 13 years and technology for probably 25 plus. And you know, one of the great things about computers is we can measure everything, or they tell us anyway. But the thing I've learned over my time is, you can, as Albert Einstein said before we all worked on PCs, everything that can be counted does not necessarily count, and everything that counts cannot necessarily be counted. And I think that perfectly sums up what we need, or what the dilemma and the problems we face with security metrics. We can measure just about anything. And we can use these metrics to show it, you know, five ways from Sunday, and we can make it show anything we want it to show, it seems. But just because we can measure something doesn't mean we should. And which security, what should we be measuring? Who do we show it to? Who's interested in it? And how do we show it to them? And that's what we're going to discuss today. We've kind of divided the load between us. Andrew's going to lead off in terms of what metrics to measure. So, Andrew?
Thanks, Alan. Go ahead. I appreciate that. Really, I wanted to kind of lay a quick foundation up front, right? And I wanted to relate what I consider to be valuable and very meaningful metrics, right? So I believe that metrics need to convey a clear picture. I need to be able to understand very quickly, within a few seconds, what this metric is trying to relate to me. And I believe that it needs to be actionable information that's being portrayed within this metric. I need to understand the effect that I can have on the information to be able to either positively or, positively impact it so that that I understand, you know, what's going on. In addition, I firmly believe this, I want the metrics to support business objectives, and that's where the real challenge comes in. So can, you know, metrics be effectively measured across the enterprise? You know, that's the core of this discussion, and relating them to the business objectives is, I feel like, you know, really where the meat of the subject comes in. The hard questions. You know, as Alan said, in prior roles, I was managing information security teams in hospitality and in other roles as well. And the major problems that I had in those roles, and even in my current role within enterprise security services with various clients, is demonstrating what information to put in front of the various departments or especially the executives. So how do we demonstrate the effect that we're having on the business? And I find what ends up happening typically, especially the first few times, that we take metrics or try to demonstrate metrics to the executive level is they're way too technical. They don't understand what's going on, and they honestly end up not caring. especially if they see it several times over, right? So I think the response that I've heard is, this is what you're paid to do. What does it have to do with me, right? And that's a discouraging, it's a discouraging note, right? So we want to be able to turn that around. And I think that how we, how the information is impacting the business objectives, what the relationship is to that, that's the real linkage, the connection, the relationship that we need to define, but we can't do it alone. So it does require their involvement. And then finally, how are we aligning the information security program as a whole to those business objectives? How are we supporting it? We're not just combating threats. We need to be working with the business. And this is a common theme, and I think fairly accepted, that if we're aligning ourselves with the business objectives, that we are, we're going to be successful. There's going to be pitfalls along the way, but ultimately, I believe it's the right course of action. So I wanted to put up kind of a framework for the way that I view, this relationship, being able to bring that consolidated view of security metrics across the enterprise into play. And now, I don't want to take credit for this. The reality is that in HP, we have some very intelligent individuals, and we're focused on this topic. We believe that this is a critical topic within information security. And so working with them, we've kind of defined this as you've got, for lack of a better way of saying it, two roles here, right? You've got the stakeholders within the business, and that can be very widespread. That could be departmental all the way up to the executives. We need their involvement, as I said before. We have all this data at our fingertips, so we can leverage that data, right, to be able to take the information, define those business objectives, understand the threats, the vulnerabilities, the risks to that data, right, and to that objective, make those linkages and relationships, and be able to effectively create some metrics, right, that that will show how we're affecting that relationship to the objective itself. And like I said, these objectives are not just executive level objectives. Of course, that's where they're defined from the top, but it needs to be relatable to every individual. I say every, anyone who's willing to work with us on defining those objectives and making them work.
Thank you, Andrew.
Thank
you. So certainly, this is the money shot of Andrew's three slides, and this is actually, as Andrew mentioned, it's an HP slide that we lifted, but it shows a great flow of, the stakeholders kind of setting what their objectives are, because it's hard to tell the stakeholders what their objectives should be. And then the security response is identifying the risk and how it all flows to, hopefully, to the far left, where we have the effect on business objectives.
Absolutely.
Jody, Ivana, before we move on, any comments, questions, or?
Well, the one comment I'd make is that Andrew is certainly not alone. We recently did a study, Ponymon actually did a study that we worked with Ponymon on, and the two things that jump out at me regarding what you said was, one, the vast majority of respondents said that security needed to align with the business objectives. The other comment was, less than a quarter of the same respondents said that they actually did align with business objectives. So, interested to hear your thoughts, in particular, Ivana, or yours, Andrew, which is it possible, and how do you go about doing that? Clearly, there's a disconnect. I think we all agree that it should align with business objectives. How do you go about making it happen?
And Ivana's going to answer or try to answer this in her next couple of slides. But again, Jody, in my years, I think that's one of the difference between security administrators, and I don't know how many people in this room, if you want to give a show of hands, how many of you consider yourself security administrators versus security managers who are reporting to the exec or board level? So security administrators, versus security managers. So we have overwhelmingly security managers here. So you guys live this all the time. My problem was always getting the security administrators to realize I got to go talk business with these people. I've got to give them something that matters. Not that we have 1,000 critical vulnerabilities, but don't worry, 900 of them aren't really real or aren't really important or germane to us. If I show them we have 1,000 critical vulnerabilities, they just say, we have 1,000 vulnerabilities. What does it mean? And so, you know, that there's an art. I think it's more of an art than a science, unfortunately, to being a security manager and communicating to these people while still being able to talk to and manage these people. That's Ivana's job, and she's going to tell us how she deals with it.
Sure. Thank you very much. So I think most of us, as Andrew, you introed it very well, and Jody, you restated it as well. I think as a security professional, depending on the reporting structure in every company, it depends, and we always struggle on how do we measure security? How do we measure what's important, and how do we demonstrate that to our CISOs, to our board of directors, to our audit team, to our risk team? What are those valuable metrics that can help us in day in, day out world? A lot of us struggle, I think, on a daily basis on determining how much is enough when it comes to security metrics. And a lot of executives, I think, in a different companies think that more metrics and more details they have, the better the security posture. A lot of them struggle as well, thinking that reaching 100% is where all of us need to be and need to go. I don't think that reaching 100% necessarily would mean we are more secure or less secure if we are less than 100%. Examples on the patching and end-of-life support. So I divided the three slides that I have on the importance of metrics to different levels of leaders, managers, and engineers in each organization. And in my opinion, I don't think that the detailed metric on how many user accounts should or have been longer than 90 days or less than 90 days, non-expiring passwords, I wouldn't think that those are some of the metrics that would matter to our C-levels, CISOs, CIOs, CEOs, as well as the board. So my first slide will speak on the metrics that I would think are important to our board and CISO, C-level leaders. My second slide will talk more about the metrics that directors or VPs, managers would be tracking. And then the third slide will talk about these detailed metrics on day-in, day-out basis that team leaders, engineers might be looking forward to and reviewing. So when it comes to C-level metrics, I provided a few examples. So what does it that matters to our C-level and board? To start with the current state of security, that would be one of the metrics, or current risk posture. I think that the board is interested in our trending. How do we actually how have we been trending when it comes to these security metrics, to our security initiatives? Every company has probably a list of major security initiatives we're tracking. So our C-level would probably like to know where do we stand when it comes to security initiatives the company is investing money, and how is our budget performing based on the investments in security? And I think throughout the few sessions that have been going on over the past few days, a lot of us always are told, well, security just spends money. You guys just spend money. It's always the investment. What do we get in return? And of course, the return, unless we get breach, is a great return. And I think that these security initiatives and traction against the budget and performance of the security initiatives is one of the metrics that would be very beneficial. Another metric is all of us have to respond to a lot of regulators, a lot of audits. Depending on what type of industry we're in, there is SSA 16, there is FISMA, HIPAA. So what are these initiatives, or what are the trends when it comes to these audits? How many outstanding items do we have? How many have we remediated, and how many are outstanding for more than 30 days or 60 days? So those are some of the regulations that are actually, in many instances, driving some of our security initiatives as well. Also, what would be interesting metric for our C-level would be benchmark or trend report. I know that at the C-level, a lot of us want to know, how do we benchmark against other companies that are in the same type of business? So where do we stand, and how can our security measure the security of other companies that stay in the same business? So those are just few examples. But when it comes to the C-level, I would probably keep it at a high level and try to provide as many trends as possible. I think trends show how much progress we make on a quarterly basis, on a monthly basis, and it's better to stay high level, tied to the budget and business objectives, instead of going too deep into details.
Ivana, before, with so many security managers in the audience, before we move to management metrics, let's stay on that C-level, board level, for just a moment. Jody, Andrew, anything to add on your experiences?
Yeah, I'd like to speak to that. So I completely agree with you, Ivana, in that sense that with the C-level execs, they want that scorecard, that red, yellow, green of is it working or is it not working, as well as the, you know, how am I trending over a period of time, right?
God bless you.
If I invest $250,000, you know, is it having an impact, you know, over time, right? Mm-hmm. Am I actually getting my money's worth out of this investment, right? And it provides accountability for the decisions that we make as security individuals that way, right? Managers, directors, and CISOs. So I completely agree with what you're saying.
Thanks. Jody?
Yeah, just a couple of things. I think it's a great slide. I think the key thoughts trending makes perfect sense. But the comment that I would have is that it's important from a C-level perspective, and quite honestly, I think this applies all the way down, but is to measure the things that you can impact. In a C-level perspective, they don't need to see the list of items that happen outside in the world or the list of vulnerabilities that Microsoft announced on Patch Tuesday, because they're out of your control anyway.
Right.
I think it's much more important that we present the message about here's the spend that we put forward from a security perspective, and here is the effect that we have. The only other comment I would make is that as a security industry, I think we're a little bit scared for our job, and we have a tendency not to report anything negative up to the board.
Yeah.
And I think to be as successful and tied to the business objectives, we've got to get over some of that fear and just report the reality as opposed to trying to report rosy metrics.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say, I think that's a fantastic point, Jody. The reality is we need to be okay to fail, right? You can't succeed 100% of the time. So you may want to choose carefully, but but I agree. I think that's a great point.
I mean, I would just quickly add before we go on, I remember back in my days at Still Secure, we were doing customer experience with CIOs and CISOs about what reports do they want for vulnerability management. And to your comment on trends, so many CISOs and CIOs would tell us, look, all I want is the diffs. I just want the differentials because I've got to show the exec team where we were last month, where we are this month, where we were the month before that, and hopefully the arrow points up. And to them, that was the single most important report they can have was the diffs. And finally, it sung through my thick skull, and we did a great differential report. The other thing I would mention is about budget. I've spoken to so many security people because I've sold security as well, where, you know, if I'm over budget, let's wait until we have budget discussions. I don't necessarily want to bring up the bad news. I don't want to bring up, you know, that our risk is really pointing down. And to Jody's point, that is a real big problem in our industry is I've seen two profiles. There's the sky is falling, right? Oh, woe is me. We are so vulnerable. We're so vulnerable. We're so insecure. You got to do something. I need more budget. I need more people. I need more shiny toys. And then there's the person who says, well, I'm going to try to just stick my head in the sand. You guys aren't interested anyway, and I'll deal with it down here. Between those two extremes lays where we need to be. And I don't think we get to where we need to be quite enough. But Ivana, why don't we jump on to management metrics?
Sure. So when it comes to management metrics, I think we still want to keep it We still want to show the trending analysis of our metrics, but I think instead of reporting at a high level initiatives, the managers, depending on the structure, but security in the security organization, CISO might have quite a few direct reports. Each one of us would hold our own budget and have the list of initiatives we're driving along with our functions that we're supporting. So based on that function that we perform and the role we play, I think will come the list of metrics as well that each director or VP would be tracking on a monthly basis. I know at some places we go to excessive daily tracking, weekly tracking, 35 slides. I would still try to keep the management director or VP level metrics to the top three slides, perhaps, where we don't have to go, again, down deep into detailed metrics on what system, what type of vulnerability. So when it comes to these metrics, a few that I would point out would be the vulnerability management and patch report. So the list of high, medium, low, critical vulnerabilities, external and internal. So we would want to know our trends. We would want to know where we were last month versus this month on our Qualys or our Nexpose or third-party scans. Incident response times, it's another valuable metric that helps managers as well. Each one of us, I'm sure, has the security awareness program and the policy, and we require our associates to take those tests. So in different companies, even manager bonuses are tied to a number of associates who take these tests, and that would be maybe something that we track. If we have contractors on staff, we would want to make sure that they take the security awareness training, that they pass the security awareness training, and that they're aware of our security policy. Total percent of systems patched, again, and total percent of systems if we have end of life. I'm sure nobody here has any NT boxes still running in production. So when it comes to these metrics, I think it's important to keep it at a high level, but we would want to know the percentage of compliance versus total population of our assets towards the security policy that we implemented.
So guys, Ivana's slides are chock full of great metrics for each of these. They're available. Will anyone who asks, we'll get you a copy offline quicker so you can take it with you. Because the next slide, I think you're going to find really.
It's too much.
Go ahead, Ivana.
This slide, it's not busy at all. Again, there's just a few metrics, and I think what I provided to Alan was probably 3 pages worth of metrics, and I think he just handpicked a few of them. And I'm not going to certainly go and talk about each one of those. I think here's where our team leaders and in some instances our engineers will be focused on are much, much more detailed metrics. So depending again on the function, not all of these will apply to each function, each role. So if we have the user provisioning, access provisioning team, we're going to look at non-expiring user accounts. We will look at the accounts depending on our policy on the passwords that haven't been changed for more than 90 days. On service accounts, we might have a mainframe with quite a few service accounts and passwords that haven't been changed for over 365 days. So as a manager of that provisioning team, those are some of the metrics that would be of interest to us. When it comes to top emerging exploits and vulnerabilities and attackers, we would want to know what are those targets that are being attacked constantly, so we can proactively take measures in securing our perimeter. And also when it comes to ingress, egress, we would also want to know from insider threats what are the things that we can straighten and better our security posture. The number of the vulnerabilities, again, the detail about each vulnerability, it's proactive way of our self-checking and self-assessment. So we would want to know self-check and self-assess with our internal scans so that we can proactively as organization work across the board in addressing those. Instead of waiting on our third party or the external vulnerability scan to determine that. So a lot of metrics, a lot more detail. So I would try not to over-measure, but as a direct manager and leader of a certain team, you would want to know the details for these metrics.
I have a comment on this, but Jody, Andrew, any comment on it?
In my slides, I haven't addressed the engineering metrics for a specific reason. It's that I think these metrics are very well defined by your technology tools. Mm-hmm. These are readily available in nearly every product that you purchase, whether it's a OS systems management platform or the vulnerability management platform, as Alan said earlier, right? That was the first thing you did,
right,
was present these metrics before you got to the C-level. So these are readily available, and I think, depending, of course, make good choices on which tools you buy, but these are readily available. And so I think the challenge that we face isn't generating these metrics. I think a bigger challenge we face as an industry is that we tend to use these metrics and publish them up to the management and
to the C-level.
Yeah, to the C-level. Yep.
And I do. I think that is really, so to me, guys, this is the crux of the problem and the dilemma that 95% of you face in this audience today, is this is what we, this is what we need. And we don't do it for good times, right? It's our jobs, but this is what we need when we look at. That's the level of detail. And Ivana is right. I filtered out. She sent me three pages. I put in what I thought was really, really important. But this is the level of detail we need to work with down here every day. And somehow or another, we've got to boil that down to five lines or whatever to report to our managers and to the C-levels and the board about what our state of security is and why we may need more resources or why we're not doing as well as we could, or we are doing as well, whatever. But how do we translate the value of these back without drowning them in this? And it's a dilemma. It's more of an art than a science, and it's why we're all here today.
So yeah, and I'd like to speak to that real quickly too, Alan. The reality is that the metrics themselves, they're too technical, as I said before, right? They don't understand that's what we're paid to do. However, the data itself that supports these metrics, that's what's critical, right? That's what we need to be able to roll up and really incorporate into those metrics that provide that overall picture, the high-level picture that shows what our actual status and progress of our information security programs and the impact that we're having on those objectives.
And also, just to add to that, I think a lot of us are looking at these slides and saying, wow, how can I get to this level or that level? That's impossible. There's way too many tools. And every time we have a vendor comes in, they all show us their nice dashboard and say, here are the list of metrics, and I'll help you report on this. But what we need is that high-level dashboard, and a lot of times it's within slide decks that we provided to our C-level, how we can get all these tools actually to provide us real-time dashboard that at any time we can see the high-level drill down to a detail level metrics and be able to show that real-time instead of spending months and hours and days generating these slides and metrics for the C-level or the board.
And that's a perfect, and if there's one thing you're going to take out of this, it's not all about providing metrics to the C-level. We do need these metrics to do our jobs, right? And I'm not saying C-level people don't care or aren't smart about security. Maybe they're not, maybe they are. But we need different metrics for different audiences and for different tasks, and that's a different set of metrics at different levels. And I think that's really the point of Ivana's slides. But we're running behind time, so I want to move over to Jody. And I tasked Jody with giving us a very different sort of view. Jody, besides being a president of FireMon, which is a security vendor that sells products around metrics, is also president of a company that's very security conscious, and has to make sure that his stuff is secure. So I asked him to not only talk as FireMon security vendor, but I asked him to talk as company president. What does he look for to make sure his company is secure? So Jody?
And this was, you know, the conversation from Andrew and Ivana is really just great, a great segue into what I had to talk about. And my first slide, I think, is interesting. And it's just at least my personal opinion, that there is no industry agreement on what to measure. I put the note that where's the MBA of security? You think about why we make decisions from a business perspective, you know, from my perspective of running a company, and it's about revenue and bookings. It's about leading indicators of what is it in my business that's going to indicate that I'm headed in the right direction financially. There is no similar strategy from the security perspective. Every vendor, we're certainly guilty of this as well, says that we've got the perfect mousetrap and I'm going to give you the dashboard that you need. And then there's very little consensus among the industry that we should measure exactly this, and this is going to make you a good security company. In fact, just as an anecdote, as part of preparation for this, I asked a number of people what they thought about security metrics, and I asked a CISO, who I respected, I should say, I still respect, but I said, what metrics do you use when you report to the board? And her answer was, I don't use metrics. I thought, okay, well, I understand that there are some problems with the metric data that's available, but okay, what do you use to report to the board? And she said, well, all those metrics are meaningless anyway. We can make them look and spin them any way we want, and so I just don't provide any of that data to the board. Okay, well, how do you justify your budget? Well, I just kind of go by my feelings. I'm like, well, how do you justify when they say they're going to cut your budget? She goes, well, it hasn't happened yet. But, well, good luck. But we've got to do something. We have to report what we do as a group, as an industry, to promote that we're doing the right things. And that's where we talk about trending, to suggest at least that we're moving in the right direction. But I would posit that we're measuring the wrong things most of the time. I would start with the fact that most security vendors, and us included, but certainly firewall vendors, SIM vendors, and others, vulnerability vendors for that matter, are showing you your successes. If you ever deployed a SIM, one of the very first things that they encourage you to do is take in firewall logs, and they'll show you the number of firewall drops. Why in the world are we measuring drops from a firewall? I mean, congratulations, the tool did exactly what it's supposed to do. Now, I'm not saying that there's not value. You know, we talk about the engineering. At some point, you're going to get down and say, okay, well, there was a port scan that I should look at, and that makes sense. But measuring that from an executive level makes no sense whatsoever. I also would suggest that we tend to measure the things that we can't control, which is, again, the exact wrong information to promote up in the organization. We measure things like threats. Again, great information to have if you're trying to build your program, great information for a manager and certainly for an ops team to respond to. But to say there's a lot of bad people in this world and use that as a metric to the executive board makes no sense. Similarly with vulnerabilities. I think that there is a ton of information that we can glean from how we manage vulnerabilities, but to promote that we have 10,000 vulnerabilities or that we now have 9,999 and we're better is absolutely wrong. What we need to be measuring are things that we control, like what is my average time to patch a vulnerability, and is that dropping from 30 days to 22 days? That's what I control. I can't control the fact that there was a new vulnerability found in Apache. I have no control over that. I do have control over how fast I address those vulnerabilities. So I think that's what we need to focus on, is what can we control, and that's the information that we need to be capturing from metrics.
So, you know, and I'd like to add on to that, Jody. I think you're spot on here. The reality is that, you know, and I would add one thing to that. So not only do we need to be measuring, you know, time, you know, from vulnerability to patch, but in relation to policy compliance as well, right? We need to understand, are we doing what we say we're doing? Because when we get compromised, the reality is that they're going to hold our feet to the fire, right? So if we understand that that we're meeting or we're not meeting, you know, we can adjust accordingly within the management.
Ivana?
And also just to add to that, I absolutely agree, especially when it comes to vulnerabilities. I think a lot of us are tempted to use the programs like vulnerability management to actually drive certain initiatives across organizations. So we're going to use the vulnerability management report and say, okay, here's the end of life. We need to replace end of life. Instead of having that asset lifecycle program and accountability at a certain level to drive the proactive patching, the end of life addresses. So I see more that these metrics, including vulnerability management program, are used as compliance check against all the initiatives and programs that should be set and driven within the organization instead of a push to get dollars and budget to address end of life. So absolutely.
Excellent. So, Jody, you have some brand new, I don't think they've been published or recently?
Yeah, no, this is brand new, over 600 respondents, great survey, great response from a wide range of people. And I just pulled out a couple of nuggets. This report will be published soon, but a really interesting survey related to this topic. And a couple things that we've already talked about, one that very few people are reporting their failures up in the organization, a lot of them not reporting at all. When an incident happens, there is a recognition that metrics matter, but a vast majority of people feel that the metrics that are in use today are not providing value when it comes to things like IT risk, threat prevention, and that's a problem. Clearly, these are things that we should be focusing on. And then the comment, Andrew, in line with what you had said before, and it's that a vast majority of people feel that current metrics do not align with the business objectives, and yet they should. So it really just some data points just supporting what Ivana and Andrew already talked about today.
Sure. We've gotten to the point of blowing right through metrics into reports on why metrics are useless without addressing two issues. One is, all of you have talked lovely measures. I haven't heard any discussion on metrics yet. Metrics are derived from measures and report on a distance between your objective or your goal and where your current state is. Could you please talk about metrics, not measures? Thank you.
It's fair enough. So I think when Ivana and Andrew were talking about trending, you can't trend anything unless you're measuring it against something. So it's absolutely a number, but it was a number based on an objective. Now, again, I think there's some consensus that we have a hard time associating or aligning our measurements with our business objectives, which means that we don't end up with metrics. It's a great point. But when you trend anything, you better start with a baseline that says this was my goal of what I was trying to achieve, and that should have been measured against an objective. So in that sense, I think we have been talking about metrics, but oftentimes you do get lost in the numbers of, again, I think we've acknowledged that the number of vulnerabilities is not a metric, it's a number.
Right.
But how do you then make that a metric? One of those was, for example, defining what your window is to patch a high vulnerability. And as a business objective, if that is, we'd like to do it within 7 days, and I'm now measuring that I'm tending to be between 7.5 and 8.2 days, then I'm not in line with my business objective, and that's the metric.
Right.
So I think to a large degree we are talking about metrics, but you pointed out one of our great failures. We're taking a lot of numbers as an industry, failing to align them with the business objective, and therefore we're not creating a metric at all.
Mm.
Fair point.
So, good, Jody.
Yeah, so I just threw up a slide. This happens to be from my product. I've got another slide from another product. I'm not trying to give a product pitch here, but it is consistent with something that I think is appropriate. It really goes straight to what Ivana was saying when it came to the C-level metrics that matter. And one of her key bullet points was measuring either security exposure or IT risk. And I'm paraphrasing. Apologize for that. But this is a point that I really like to stress. It's something that I think we do fairly well. But it's that we have a lot of silos of information. You spend over half of your security budget, and I'm obviously making assumptions for everyone in this room, but you spend over half of your security technology budget on firewalls. Then you go spend another portion on vulnerability assessment. You spend another portion on IPS and maybe some threat defense or threat intelligence. But how do you pull all that information together? If all you have is individual silos of information that says, here are my vulnerabilities, here are my firewalls, but you don't know how the two correlate, then how are you effectively securing your organization? It's like, in fact, not only do we buy separate technologies, but in most organizations, I don't know if it's true for you, Ivana or Andrew, but they're even run from completely separate departments.
Mm-hmm.
The IT security team or audit team runs the vulnerability assessment programs, and the network security team runs the firewalls, and the two shall never meet. And yet, you bought those security technologies, you bought those firewalls to limit risk, and they should be limiting the access to those vulnerable hosts in what I call limiting exposure, right? So that, to me, that's a measure. That's measuring your security exposure. Let's take these multiple security technologies and these multiple measures and say, I don't just need to know how many vulnerabilities I have. I'd like to know how many of those vulnerabilities are exposed to the threats. So we take those three different points, my threat intelligence data that says here is where my biggest threat is coming from, my list of vulnerability data, and then those security controls that I put in place to try to limit risk and say, where is my real exposure? And that's what I'm going to measure. Is it perfect? I'm sure everybody could quibble and say, no, that's not perfect, and here's why. But I think it's a big step forward. Let's measure that and trend that, you know, to trend that exposure, which is what's showing in that upper right-hand corner of trending that exposure. Now, the reason why I think it's a great metric to measure is that if you're trending that exposure, you're not just measuring the vulnerabilities, you're measuring the effectiveness of your people that are making changes to that security infrastructure day over day. And are those changes they're making effective? Are they moving you in the right direction? So we're pulling together lots of different information and measuring the things that we control as opposed to measuring the things we don't control.
Excellent. You, commenting on that, Jody, there was a long time where I thought, I talked to people and they thought SIMS would do that job, right? Rather than just pulling in information and events from all of these disparate systems Jody mentioned, they never really delivered the punchline, which is kind of what does it all mean? How do I put it all together into one picture rather than just all of these different components in one screen? And then we have GRC solutions that try to do this. There's a lot of different kind of, the security industry is never at a loss for taking venture capitalist money and coming up with new ideas for dashboards or reports, but are we really doing metrics, as this gentleman said? So, Jody, I think...
Last slide. So this is Lockbath. It's a GRC company. I brought it up because I thought it did a nice job of capturing this idea of measuring failures, taking your incidents and promoting those within the organization. I think we're a little too scared as an industry sometimes to promote that, but measuring your incidents that have occurred and trending them. Are you getting better or worse? There's another product that I haven't put up here, but BitSight, interesting company, helped address one of the problems that Ivana mentioned, which is an outside perspective. So being able to measure yourself against peers in your industry. And it takes a very black box approach that says, I see this kind of stuff emanating from your network, you know, malware, spam, et cetera. So based on that, we can assign some measurement to your effectiveness of your security program and measure you against the others in the industry. But it is really measuring of your failures. You know, I love last year and a couple of years ago, there was a lot of topic around Moneyball. And even at RSA, I think there was a couple of topics around that conversation. And I think of security metrics and where we're at today, we're not trying to get to the level of Moneyball where we're measuring things like on-base percentage. I still think we're trying to figure out wins and losses. We're not even measuring our losses effectively to say that this was an incident and therefore I can learn what went wrong and improve my organization. So we're a long ways from really optimizing our ability to measure metrics. But I guess I would disagree with that CISO I spoke to, that they don't matter. I think they absolutely matter. It's going to take some effort and time to figure out what to measure and how to measure it.
So I want to just leave you with a couple of slides on what we should be taking away from our discussion today before we open up to questions. And I've broken them up into what you should be going home and doing immediately if you're not already doing, or maybe rethinking what you're doing right now. And I think Ivana's slides and discussion is really germane to this. We need to understand what it is we should measure for and report to who, and do they align with our business objectives, right? And obviously, if there's, as I said earlier, different audiences are interested in different measurements and different metrics and different reports. Understand and try to shape your program around that. How do you understand that? It says up here, right? You get to meet with your various constituents. You need to meet with the various levels here. Understand what's important to them. You know, I don't know how many of you read the Phoenix Project by Gene Kim. It's an excellent novel. It's not a how-to book. It's a great read, quick read. You'll read it on the plane home from here. One of the things that I thought was really, their acting CIO went to the CFO, to the VP of marketing, to the VP of sales, to the head of development, to the security, to the CISO as well, and asked, what's important? What do you want me to prioritize? What do you want me to do? If you don't have that conversation as a security manager with all your constituents, You're not going to guess it right. Better to let, they may not know what they want, but at least let them tell you what they think they want. Mm-hmm. And you're on the right track. Okay? Then I think you need to do take a good look in the mirror and say, what am I capable of providing today? What you know, people want this, but I'm over here, I can't give them that. So what are our capabilities to measure? Right? What are our capabilities to report? What tools and you know what do we, and for to get from here to here? What am I going to need? Right? Do I need tools? Do I need people? Do I need expertise? What do we need here? So that was 0 to 3 months, 6 to 12 months. You should be running. You're up in place. I mean, it's a constant you know reiteration and polishing of it, but deliver what you can now and try to get to where you need to be, you know, in an appropriate time level. Budgeting, implementation timelines, I think this is where a place where a lot of us fail, right? We tend to either ask for too much or too little to really get the job done, and we, you know, and executives don't want to hear it's a two-year program to get something in place. They want to know why you can't do it in 30 days. We certainly can't do it in 30 days. But again, realistic timelines. And then going back, and I think it is a constant recalibrating of what team, have the business goals changed? Have the teams changed? Have the outlooks changed? We need to keep up on that. So we're down to, we're at the question section of our session, and we'd welcome any questions if anybody wants to come up here on the mic. And this gentleman.
Could you give us your feedback on using ROI to prioritize and evaluate security investments?
That's a loaded one. Okay.
It may point a little bit to that paradigm that we're sort of into between, is IT and security an expenditure or a revenue support? Thanks.
Anybody want to take first crack at that?
Sure. In an overall sense, I have a hard time advocating ROI from security. That's not to say that there aren't things that we can do from an ROI perspective. For example, if you already have a patch management system in place, you might be able to go buy a technology that automates some of that patching and therefore generates an ROI from where you're at today, but that's not the same thing as saying that security has an ROI. I think going in front of the board or to an executive with a story that security should have an ROI and that's why we're in business is a stretch, probably a tough sell. I think it's a losing proposition. I think the reality is it's an insurance program. Yes. What are you willing to spend to protect what you have? And it's about how can you do it efficiently under what budget constraints? And then it gets to these stories of metrics to help validate why you're spending the money that you're on. But I'm not saying there aren't chances for ROI in a tactical sense based on what you're currently spending and how maybe you could do it more efficiently. But as an overall program, I'm not a believer in security ROI.
Yeah, neither am I. I don't think it's hard to justify return on investment when it comes to security. No breach, no incidents, I think it's good enough.
Yeah, and I would agree, absolutely. Qualifying and quantifying these risks that we have to the organization, when you begin to bring in other sources, legal, and there's expenses to risk, from the risk departments, legal, et cetera, you can begin to create some numbers and costs here, but each of these are assurance measures that we're not low-hanging fruit, right? So to create an ROI is a really tough sale. I completely agree with that.
I mean, I would just add, my Social Security, we've had ROI calculators for everything, and I just found them to be a lot of... They were the classic security metrics. They could show anything, anywhere. And I'm saving you $4 million by having an IPS and of your $20,000 company. But I'm going to agree. Gentlemen here.
Good afternoon. You're approaching ROI all wrong. Take a look at the amount of companies that purchased your products after evaluating your security posture. Just track the number of security surveys that your team fills out. Track who amongst those who submit to you security surveys then wind up purchasing from your company against the amount of companies that have you fill those out that don't purchase from you, against the amount of companies that purchase from you without putting you through that kind of rigor. That allows you to track the percentage of your business that you're bringing in based upon the strength of your information security. That is a measurement of return on investment.
I agree with you, but just like you said, we weren't measuring metrics instead of numbers. You're measuring ROI of a security company selling a security thing.
Actually, my company doesn't sell security.
No, but when you say he should measure ROI based on...
Yeah, I mean, I think the story here is Target, right? So what does Target lose if they have a breach?
Right.
How many people don't come back to the store? I get it, right? But now give me a credible measure that I can say that the security program is measurable ROI. That's where I struggle. I'm not saying that there's not. It's a positive investment.
Yes.
An organization must invest in security. So It's the measurement of ROI as the justification for security is where I think it's very difficult to achieve. Is there an ROI associated with it? I hope so. That's why we invest in it, right? Otherwise, why would you spend any money on it? I just don't think it's an effective measure of the security program.
And just quickly on target, I would, and this is a topic for another panel, I would say 6 to 12 months from now, this whole thing on target is a blip on their financials. Their stock isn't going to have a long-term effect, and the $200 million or whatever they're saying it's cost them, 12 months from now, it's way in the rearview mirror. And that's the problem. The real problem is that fraud in retail is 5 cents on $100 worth of sales. And at 5 cents on $100 worth of sales, it doesn't move the needle. And so what do you want them to do on 5 cents for 100? Go ahead.
It seems to me that one of the challenges we have is that we are specialists in the risk management business. And you look at all the different disciplines that come to play here, it's hard to refocus and say, what is the metric? So to me, this whole session points to an unspoken call to arms on some sort of industry standard for how we're going to look at this. Are you aware of any efforts that are underway to develop a standard? Because it seems to me it's incumbent on us to get our act together and put something forward.
The security MBA.
Yeah, security MBA. It's a good point. There are a ton of efforts underway that do exist related around this concept of risk. Josh?
Corbin?
Fair, F-A-I-R, the Fair.
Jack Jones.
Jack Jones, thank you. It's certainly not the only one, but a great example where it's how do we effectively measure risk and how do you assign asset values and, even to the point of ROI, it's not driving to an ROI, but how do you evaluate how much should you spend on security to protect the assets that you have underway? And the challenge that we run into is, even as security vendors, and I'll throw myself under the bus here with this, look, I'm tasked to make money. I'm tasked to sell a product that delivers some solution to you that has value, but risk is a tough problem to solve. And so as an industry, no one has effectively gone out and done it. Now there's a process, and the FAIR program from Jack Jones is a great paper. If anybody in this room is not familiar with it, do a Google search, find it. It's a great paper, a great read, and it's actually fairly thin in the realm of risk programs. I think it's 20, 30 pages long, and you get a
what
really good gist.
What does FAIR stand for people who may not know? Doesn't it? And that, it is excellent. I mean, it's not the security MBA, but I find it very useful. Sir.
All right, terrific. Well, listen, thank you very much. This has been helpful for me. Ivana, I particularly like some of the slides that you, or the slide you developed that talked about at the executive level, how do we talk about this and how do we demonstrate the value? So what's important and what should we show? And it came out in yesterday's CISO roundtable about 4 or 5. So 4 or 5, the end of the day, and then this one's at the beginning of the day. This is some rough times, right? Rough time slots. But the ability to compare. So in other words, we look at things from inside of our sandbox, but I think one of the things that a lot of us struggle with is how do we define what good looks like? So as we look at what others are doing in our corresponding industry, something where we can say, okay, we're doing all these things and we're seeing this. The truth is, good, bad, this is what it is. But for others in our segment, this is what we also see. So could you speak to that at all? Are there things that you're using as you start talking to these senior executives that might be helpful for us as we start to demonstrate that value?
Well, I think that there's multiple ways to do that. I think looking at the trending analysis from, starting even with Gartner or Forrester or any of other, companies that do measure and compare, not just technologies, but who are these leaders and how do we rank against those leads? What are the top initiatives in the industry? Starting even, how do we measure certain things and the best guidance methodologies? What I like is I like to put the framework first. So most of us work around framework and controls. So what are these frameworks that we put in place, the controls that we tie to the frameworks that are part of frameworks, and then the process that actually responds to that framework. Mm-hmm. And then we end up measuring that process and compliance with the process, which I think ties exactly to one of the points that you referred to. That's what we can measure, how effective, efficient our processes are, mm-hmm. and then tie that to Gartner, to Forrester, to other, you know, a lot of also security vendors provide that data, that already collect the data, compare, and that's how they provide us their statistics as well.
It really is process and people in this framework, but just as a product perspective, I mentioned it earlier, BitSight, there's probably a number like it. I just happen to know Stephen Boyer, who started that company recently. Think of it like a Dun & Bradstreet of security, where they are going out and through their algorithms taking in all this outside perspective and saying, this company gets a score of 72, you measure up against the rest of your industry like this. It's an interesting perspective. And then if you measured that over time, how did the controls that you put in place and the changes that you put in place affect that external perspective of you? I think it's a neat story. I should, in full disclosure, I have very little knowledge of how effective it works. I just happen to know Stephen, and the story he tells is a powerful one. And I think it's a neat story if it works effectively.
The bit site?
Bit site, yeah.
Bit site. Okay, I'm not familiar either. Thank you very much, sir. Well, this works out perfectly because it looks like there's no other questions, and we're out of time. So before I wrap up, thank you all so much for coming out today. We appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of your day at RSA and the rest of your week. Thank you to Andrew, Jody, and Ivana. It's a great panel.
Thank you, Alan.
And enjoy your day.